Good morning.
Good morning.
Welcome to King of Kings on this Sunday that we would normally be celebrating the last Sunday of End Times Christ the King, but because of the circumstances, we're going to focus our thoughts on Thanksgiving. I guess that's okay, because Charles Dickens once wrote that we do things a little bit backwards here in America. We have one day of Thanksgiving. In reality, we should have 364 days of Thanksgiving and just one day that we could use to get out all our gripes and complaints and wishful thinking for other blessings. So today we're focusing on Thanksgiving, and generally we tend to focus on the circumstances of our life, the outward blessings that we have. But today we're going to do something different. Instead of focusing on blessings that may be here today, gone tomorrow, we're going to give thanks for the blessing that never changes, the blessing of salvation, the spiritual blessings of forgiveness and heaven. May that be your focus today. We'll begin with the first hymn, hymn number 611, For the Fruit of His Creation. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you.
And also with you.
I will exalt you, my God, the King.
I will praise your name forever and ever.
Every day I will praise you.
And extol your name forever and ever.
The Lord is gracious and compassionate, slow to anger and rich in love.
The Lord is good to all. He has
All you have made will praise you, O Lord. Your saints will extol you. The eyes of all look to you, and you give them their food at the proper time.
You open your hand and satisfy the desires of every living thing.
My mouth will speak in praise of the Lord.
Let every creature praise his holy name forever and
Let us pray.
Almighty
God and Father, your generous goodness comes to us new every day. By the work of your Spirit, lead us to acknowledge your goodness, give thanks for your benefits, and serve you in willing obedience through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
You may be seated. The first lesson for this morning is recorded in 1 Chronicles chapter 16, verses 7 through 36. And King David, in these words, praises God for his eternal blessings. We're going to use as our sermon text verse 34, down at the bottom of the page. David delivered to Asaph and his associates this psalm of thanks to the Lord. Give thanks to the Lord, call on his name, make known among the nations what he has done. Sing to him, sing praise to him, tell of his wonderful acts. Glory in his holy name, let the hearts of those who seek the Lord rejoice. Look to the Lord and his strength, seek his face always. Remember the wonders he has done, his miracles and the judgments he pronounced. O descendants of Israel, his servant, O sons of Jacob, his chosen one, he is the Lord our God, his judgments are in all the earth. He remembers his covenant forever, the word he commanded for 1,000 generations, the covenant he made with Abraham, the oath he swore to Isaac. He confirmed it to Jacob as a decree, to Israel as an everlasting covenant, To you I will give the land of Canaan as the portion you will inherit. When they were but few in number, few indeed, and strangers in it, they wandered from nation to nation, from one kingdom to another. He allowed no man to oppress them. For their sake he rebuked kings. Do not touch my anointed ones. Do my prophets no harm. Sing to the Lord all the earth. Proclaim his salvation day after day. Declare his glory among the nations, his marvelous deeds among all peoples. For great is the Lord and most worthy of praise. He is to be feared above all gods. For all the gods of the nations are idols, but the Lord made the heavens. Splendor and majesty are before him, strength and joy in his dwelling place. Ascribe to the Lord, O families of nations, ascribe to the Lord glory and strength. Ascribe to the Lord the glory due his name, bring an offering and come before him. Worship the Lord in the splendor of his holiness. Tremble before him, all the earth. The world is firmly established, it cannot be moved. Let the heavens rejoice, let the earth be glad, let them say among the nations, the Lord reigns. Let the sea resound and all that is in it, let the fields be jubilant and everything in them. Then the trees of the forest will sing, they will sing for joy before the Lord, for he comes to judge the earth. Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. His love endures forever. Cry out, save us, O God, our Savior. Gather us and deliver us from the nations, that we may give thanks to your holy name, that we may glory in your praise. Praise be to the Lord, the God of Israel, from everlasting to everlasting. Then all the people said, Amen, and praised the Lord. This is the word of the Lord. Praise awaits you, O God. You call forth songs of joy. The streams of God are filled with water to provide the people with grain. The grasslands of the desert overflow. The hills are clothed with gladness. The second lesson is recorded in the book of Hebrews, chapter 13, verses 5 and 6. God certainly bless us with abundant material blessings, but he wants us to keep them in perspective. Keep your lives free from the love of money and be content with what you have, because God has said, never will I leave you, never will I forsake you. So we say with confidence, the Lord is my helper, I will not be afraid. What can man do to me? The word of the Lord. Shout for joy to the Lord, all the earth.
Worship the Lord with gladness. Come before him with joyful songs.
Know that the Lord is God. It is he who made us, and we are his. Enter his gates with thanksgiving and his courts with praise. For the Lord is good and his love endures forever. Please stand. The Gospel according to Matthew chapter 6, beginning with the 25th verse. If God provides for even the most minute creatures of his creation, will he not also provide for the crown of his creation? The answer is obviously yes. Therefore, I tell you, do not worry about your life, what you will eat or drink, or about your body, what you will wear. Is not life more important than food and the body more important than clothes? Look at the birds of the air. They do not sow or reap or store away in barns, and yet your heavenly Father feeds them. Are you not much more valuable than they? Who of you, by worrying, can add a single hour to his life? And why do you worry about clothes? See how the lilies of the field grow. They do not labor or spin. Yet I tell you that not even Solomon in all his splendor was dressed like one of these. If that is how God clothes the grass of the field, which is here today and tomorrow is thrown into the fire, will he not much more clothe you, O you of little faith? So do not worry, saying, what shall we eat, or what shall we drink, or what shall we wear? For the pagans run after all these things, and your heavenly Father knows that you need them. But seek first his kingdom and his righteousness, and all these things will be given to you as well. Therefore, do not worry about tomorrow, for tomorrow will worry about itself. Each day has enough trouble of its own. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise
be to you, Lord Christ. Praise the Lord, O my soul.
All my hands will speak. Praise the Lord.
He forgives all your sins and heals all your diseases. He satisfies your desires with good things.
So that your youth is renewed like eagles.
He will not always accuse.
Nor will he ever forever.
He does not treat us as our sins deserve.
Or repay us according
to our iniquities. For as high as the heavens are above the earth, so great is his love for those who fear him. You may be seated. The hymn of the day is hymn number 612 on page 10 of your worship folder. Grace and mercy and peace are yours from God our Father and from our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. Dear brothers and sisters in Christ, O give thanks to the Lord, for he is good, His love endures forever. I have to confess that earlier on in my ministry, I would have avoided using that short of a sermon text like a sweaty customer in line at the grocery store with a persistent cough. It seems like all we would have to do is read those familiar words that we use before many of the meals that we eat. Just read the words and then say, Amen. But when you look at those two simple phrases, they are so packed with meaning. Now that I'm a little bit wiser, I probably could preach 12 sermons on those words and never even scratch the surface. But don't worry, I'm not going to keep you here past kickoff. But I do want to use those words to give you a couple thoughts to help you over this Thanksgiving celebration. King David wrote those words as part of the larger psalm that we read as the Old Testament lesson, and they were words that were written to be used as the Ark of the Covenant was placed in the temple in Jerusalem. Remember that David built kind of a temporary temple in Jerusalem. He laid the plans for the subsequent building that would be built, but it was Solomon that built the temple in Jerusalem. And David wanted to make sure the ark was there, but I want you to think about the fact that it's absolutely astounding that that celebration was taking place at all. And I say that because Jerusalem wasn't always the capital city of Israel. It was inhabited by a Canaanite tribe called the Jebusites. And it was an impenetrable city. It occupied the high ground up on a hill. It was surrounded by walls so secure that the Jebusites mocked David and his army when they came to capture it. "You'll never get in here," they said. "Even the blind and the lame will repel you." So how did David and his army do it? There was a 45-foot vertical shaft, a tunnel, that went under the walls of Jerusalem, and the Jebusites used to go down that tunnel to retrieve water from the Gihon Spring. And they would bring that water back up through the tunnel. David and his men crawled right up through that shaft, and they defeated the Jebusites, and they conquered the city, and David made it the capital of Israel. And from there, he expanded Israel's territory to its greatest extent. David wanted to make sure the Ark of the Covenant was in the temple that he built there, the temporary temple, because that, in fact, was the symbol of God's presence with his people. You remember when God led his people out of slavery, he led them with a pillar of cloud by day and a pillar of fire by night. And when they stopped to make camp for the night, that pillar of cloud would come and rest on the Ark of the Covenant. It was the symbol that God was with his people, and it made perfect sense that David wanted to occupy a central place in the temple, God's house. As I said before, the text was part of a larger psalm of thanksgiving. And there were all kinds of circumstances that David could have included in that psalm. You know, he probably could have mentioned specifically that God delivered them from slavery in Egypt. He could have talked to them about how God led them to the waters of the Red Sea. They looked like they were trapped, but God held those waters up and allowed a dry path on which they could pass. And then he brought those waters down on Pharaoh's army. He could have mentioned that. I suppose he probably could have mentioned the fact that he provided miraculous bread falling from the sky, or birds that flew close enough to the ground to capture for food. David could have talked about the fact that God allowed water to flow from a rock in the middle of the desert. He could have talked about the fact that the walls of Jericho came crumbling down simply because God instructed them to march around the city and blow in their trumpets. Could have mentioned that. He could have talked about the fact that God led them to the threshold of the promised land, and they looked inside, and it was a land occupied with fierce enemies who were not going to willingly hand over their land, but God led them to victory after victory. He could have mentioned all of those circumstances, and yet not once does he specifically mention any of those things by name. Instead, he gives thanks to the Lord because he's good. And I'm going to suggest that as we celebrate Thanksgiving this year, that we follow that very same path that David lays out. Normally what we do is we make a mental list of all of the circumstances in our lives for which we can give thanks. The clothes that we wear, the food on our table, the house in which we live, the car that we drive, good health, and all of our possessions. I suppose we could give thanks this year that, to the best of my knowledge, not one of our members here at King of Kings have come down with COVID. And we could go on making that list for the next 20 minutes about all the circumstances in our lives that are reason for which to give thanks. There's just one problem with that approach, however. What happens if the circumstances change? What happens if all of a sudden I lose my job or contract COVID? Or if I'm diagnosed with brain cancer, or if I have to leave my home and go into assisted living because my health is failing, what about the fact that my marriage isn't as happy as I want it to be, or what happens if one of my grandchildren is struggling with addiction? If God is good because of the circumstances in my life that make me joyful, then doesn't it make perfectly logical sense that when the circumstances in my life make me depressed, that God may in fact not be as good as he claims to be? Maybe God's just messing with me. Maybe he's angry with me. Maybe he's punishing me because I haven't jumped through the hoops like he'd wanted me to do. You know what? Those thoughts may be logical, but they are in fact proof. Proof that sin has so thoroughly corrupted every fiber of my being that it's even affected my logic. But let's go through an exercise this morning. Let's see how logical those ideas really are. You would say, wouldn't you, that God is all-powerful? And that because he's all-powerful, he could prevent every one of those bad things from happening to me in my life. Of course you'd say that, because God is almighty. But if God is almighty and God wants to punish me, if he wants to mess with me, if he's all-powerful, the best he can do is take away my job? The best and all-powerful God can do is make cells reproduce rapidly in my brain to produce cancerous tumors? Oh, if God is all-powerful and he wants to punish me, he can obliterate me. He can absolutely vaporize me and wipe me off the face of the earth. It is not God who is responsible for the circumstances in our life when we're not happy with them. It's not God who is responsible for my unhappy marriage. It is I and my own sinful thoughts and attitudes and actions. He's not the one who makes my life difficult because I don't do all the things he wants me to do. He's not responsible when all of a sudden I find myself without an income. No, it's this sin-infected world that is so ruined that it is now mutated and created this virus. God is not responsible for fatal car accidents. God doesn't bring about hurricanes to destroy homes and lives. Satan is responsible for that evil. Satan is responsible for twisting and warping people's minds so that they can murder and rape and steal and feel completely justified in doing every one of those acts. My own sinful nature. The sin-ruined world in which I live. Satan is responsible for every circumstance in my life that makes me anything less than joyful, but God is good. God is so good that he keeps this world from becoming so bad that it becomes a living hell. God is good, and not just because he keeps my life from being worse, and not just because he enables me to compile a mental list of all the blessings and circumstances I have in my life. God is primarily good because he supplies my greatest need. God is primarily good because he's given his own flesh and blood to bleed and to die for someone like me who questions his love. And for someone who wishes my circumstances would be different, he's lived a perfect life of trust for all of those times I've doubted his goodness and accused him of being anything less than loving. He lived and he died and he rose again with an act of inconceivable, boundless, sacrificial love. I didn't even deserve this life. This life, which all things considered is pretty good. But God gave me something so far better. He gave me and he secured for me an eternal paradise. A life, a real life that can't be affected by lost employment or COVID, declining health, brain cancer, grandchildren that are addicted, but a life free from pain and problem and crying. So make your list. Make your list as you celebrate Thanksgiving this year of all the circumstances in your life which bring you joy, but more than anything else, thank God that he's good and that he shows his goodness by bringing about your salvation. You've heard people say before, money can't buy me happiness. And then there's always someone to come right back with, yeah, that may be true, but I'd sure like to try. But would you really? I spent some time looking at some studies and reading some news articles about the connection to money and happiness this week. And their conclusions are all over the board. I don't know that we can really draw any truth from them. But I know this. I know all those studies and news articles discounted man's ability to suppress the truth. In other words, people can be so messed up that they really think happiness comes from the car that they drive and the house in which they live and the balance in their accounts. One thing is true. Even if I can delude myself into thinking that brings me happiness, it can't last forever. One day the car is going to break down, the house is going to crumble, and the bank balances can't be transferred beyond the grave. Even if I can replenish those blessings throughout this life, one day the good life is going to come to an end. It's a funny thing about wealth, we tend to look at wealth as static, don't we? In other words, once you're rich, you stay wealthy, and once you're poor, it's hard to find a way to dig yourself out of it, but that's not statistically true. People move in and out of the 1% in this country all the time. But we all find out the same thing. The more I have, the more I want. The more possessions I own, the more I have to work in order to keep them. The more things I have, the more I have to spend to maintain them. And all this stuff, All this money that's supposed to bring me happiness, to give me freedom and joy, well, they can enslave me. And they can be the source of my discontent. But if you're thanking God for the fact that he's good, if you're thanking God for salvation rather than circumstance, then you have something that truly lasts. When you're thanking God for salvation, it's not something that's here today and could slip through your fingers tomorrow. Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good, for his love endures forever. That peace that I have, peace with God, peace inside, that is absolutely secure and certain and sure, because the victory has already been won. Christ has defeated all of those enemies of sin, death, and Satan, and through faith, he lets me share in that victory. We don't have to lament that we don't have the things that we want, that we wish we'd have more, because God has already given us the greatest gift that he ever could give. We can be confident that my circumstances don't need to be different, but heaven is heaven for every single one of us exactly the same. Never do I wish that I had the resources to buy love. Money can't buy me love, because God's love is given. God's love is sure, and God's love endures forever. Let that perspective shape your thinking this Thanksgiving. No matter what you have or don't, if you're completely content with your circumstances, or if you wish that they could possibly be different, you have reason to give thanks, because the Lord is good and his love endures forever. There is not one person, there is no thing that can ever change that. Set your heart on his greatest gift, the gift of salvation. Set your heart on the righteousness he supplies in Christ. Set your heart on the Savior who hung on the cross for you. Set your heart on the kingdom and the mission that he's given you, and then you will have a happy Thanksgiving. And joy will rule your heart and your mind and your life. May God grant it. Amen. Please stand. The peace of God that transcends all human understanding, guard and keep your hearts and your minds through faith in Christ Jesus. Amen. We pray. Lord God Almighty, through the greatness of your power, all things in heaven and earth were recreated. We thank you for crowning the year with your goodness, for spreading grain over the fields, and for adorning the valleys with bounty. You have filled the earth with riches and rewarded human labor. Above all, though, we thank you for bringing us salvation through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Great is your name, O God, and marvelous is your mercy. Make your church alive with the power of the gospel. Pour out your Holy Spirit on us that we may serve you with fervent zeal, rejoicing in hope, being patient in tribulation, and continuing in prayer. Give quietness and confidence to all who may be enduring any trial of it or adversity of body, mind, or spirit, and grant them the rewards of faith and trust in you. And since our salvation is nearer than when we first believed, help us, O God, to cast off the words of darkness and to put on the armor of light, so that when our Lord Jesus Christ returns, he may, according to his promise, transform our lowly bodies and make them like his glorious body. And in his name, we join together in praying the prayer our Savior taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. You may be seated. We'll join in hymn number 613. It's found on page 12 of your worship folder. Give thanks to the Lord, who is good. Come, let us praise God joyfully.
Let us
for the good world, for things great and small, beautiful and awesome, for seen and unseen splendors. For human life, for talking and moving and thinking together, for common hopes and hardships shared from birth until our dying.
We thank you,
O God. For work to do and strength to work, for the camaraderie of labor, for exchanges of good humor and encouragement.
We thank you,
O God. For marriage, for mutual forgiveness and burden shared, for promises kept in love.
We thank you,
for family, for living together and eating together, for family amusements and family joys.
We thank you,
for the blessing of children, for the love they return to us and the opportunity to train them in your truth.
We thank you,
for growing up and growing old, for wisdom deepened by experience, for rest and leisure, for time made precious by its passing.
We thank you,
God. For your help in times of doubt and sorrow, for healing our diseases, for preserving us in temptation and danger.
We thank you, God.
For the church into which we have been called, for the good news we receive by word and sacrament, for our life together in the Lord. For your Holy Spirit, who guides our steps and brings us gift of faith and love, who prays in us and prompts our grateful worship.
We praise you,
above all, O God, for your Son, Jesus Christ, who lived and died and lives again for our salvation, for our hope in him, and for the joy of serving him. Give thanks to the Lord who is good.
God's love is everlasting.
The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look on you with favor and give you peace.
Amen.
You may be seated for a closing hymn, hymn number 609. We praise you, O God, our Redeemer.
Thank you.
Good morning. Welcome once again. Last week, we were talking about our schedule for the month of December and going forward, and the suggestion was made that we maybe would have a service on Saturday afternoon about 4 o'clock instead of having two services on Sunday morning. And I asked you to consider whether or not you would be attending a Saturday night service if we offered that. My feeling was that maybe you guys needed a little more time to think about it, so I want to ask that question again. If you would like to attend a Saturday service, just go ahead and raise your hand. About a dozen, about the same as it was last week. We'll have to consider whether or not that will serve our purpose of giving us enough room on Sunday morning as we see more winter residents coming back. I will let you know for sure next Sunday. We still have one Sunday left in November. I'll let you know for sure what the schedule will be next Sunday. Saturday after Thanksgiving, we're going to be decorating the church for Christmas. I would invite you all to come and be a part of that, 9 o'clock in the morning. We'll do our best to stay apart from one another, maybe change the way we decorate this year to help us not be right on top of one another. There will be no Thanksgiving Eve or Thanksgiving Day worship service, but I said I was going to put a devotion on the website. Having written that, it's not a devotion, it's a sermon. So I seem to have that trouble. But I'll be posting that. It'll be there for you whenever you want it on Thanksgiving Day. Last week I also handed out, or I told you that on the credenza, there was a little pamphlet that described what the new hymnal was going to be like. And after the service, those were all gone. I put two more back there on the credenza, at least before the service there were two. If you don't get one and you want one, please let me know and I will do my best to make sure that you get one. There are some other sign-up sheets for things on the credenza as well that you might want to take a look at. Anyone else have announcements? Carl. Brief council meeting. Brief council meeting right after worship, right up in front here. Any other announcements? Have a wonderful week. Enjoy your Thanksgiving celebration, keeping in mind the greatest blessing of salvation, not circumstance.